So the experiment for today is estimation of DNA by DPA method is a short name given, but it is actually diphenylamine method. Now, the aim of the experiment is to determine the concentration of DNA that is present in the given solution by using the diphenylamine method. What is the principle of this experiment? When the DNA is treated with diphenylamine under acidic conditions, a blue colored compound is formed which has a sharp absorption at 595 nanometer. And this reaction is given by 2-deoxypentoses and it is not specific for DNA. So it is deoxyribonucleic acids. So we are having the deoxyribosugar, and the deoxyribosugar present in the DNA bases only is able to undergo the diphenylamine reaction, not the nitrogenous bases. So this point be very clear. In the acidic solution, the straight chain of 2-deoxypentose is converted to a highly reactive intermediate which is called as beta-hydroxynivalenic aldehyde. And this intermediate, which is highly reactive, is the one which will further react with the diphenylamine to give a blue-colored complex. In DNA, only the 2-deoxyribose of the purine nucleotide gives the reaction. The reason is because the sugar which is present, the deoxyribose sugar present on the purine nucleotides, can break easily from the purine base and release a deoxyribose sugar to fasten and give you the faster blue color formation. Pyrimidines also will release a 2-deoxyribose, but the reaction is very, very slow. So that is why the point says that in the DNA, only the deoxyribose sugar of the purine nucleotides, it gives a positive, faster reaction. Same principle, this is the reaction over here. So this is the structure of the deoxyribose sugar. This is the first carbon, this is second carbon, third carbon, fourth carbon, fifth carbon. First carbon, we have the OH, and you had the second carbon, which is the deoxy position. So you had the two prime end or the second carbon atom without an oxygen molecule or oxygen atom over here. So that is why the sugar is called as 2-deoxyribose sugar. Okay, now this is going to be acted upon under the acidic condition. It forms what? It forms a highly reactive intermediate which is called as beta-hydroxylivalenic aldehyde. So you had the aldehyde functional group, you are having the hydroxyl group. C double bond O is also there in the center. So it gets converted into a highly reactive intermediate. Which one? The 2-deoxyribose sugar of the DNA. And this intermediate which has formed will immediately react with the DPA reagent, and it takes approximately 15 minutes for the reaction to be completed and forms a product which will be blue in color. And this blue colored, what we get, we are going to take its absorption at 595 nanometer. So this is the principle and this is the reaction which has to be to the next one. The reagents what we require for the experiment. The first reagent is a diphenylamine reagent. So for its preparation, we take 1 gram of the diphenylamine and we are dissolving it in 100 ml of the glacial acetic acid. And to this, we are supposed to add 2.5 ml of concentrated sulfuric acid. So this preparation is what is the prepared solution for diphenylamine. So the reaction says 2-deoxyribose under acidic condition. So what are the acidic environment we are providing? One is glacial acetic acid and a little concentration of the sulfuric acid. So this maintains the acidic environment for the reaction. Okay, then working standard DNA solution, and this is the concentration which we have utilized for the experiment. That is 50 milligram of the DNA is being weighed into a standard flask, and it has been dissolved with saline citrate buffer, or you call it as citrate buffered saline solution. Approximately 80 ml you can add it. First you thoroughly dissolve the substance. After it has dissolved, then make it up to 100 ml with the same saline citrate buffer solution. Once you mix it up thoroughly, the concentration of the DNA in this working standard solution will become 500 microgram per ml. Now coming to the next one, the procedure, the experimental protocol of how to do the experiment. Step number one, you are going to take a series of test tubes and you are going to pipette out the working standard DNA solution, and the volume of your pipetting must be from 0.2 to 1 ml, and every volume what you are pipetting it, the concentration will be ranging from 100 to 500 microgram per ml. Once you have pipetted out your standard solution, please make sure that we are making up the volume to 1 ml with distilled water. So 5 test tubes, label it as 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, which is corresponding to 0.2, 0.4, 0.6, 0.8 and 1 ml, and that is a volume. And the concentration in each of the tube will be from 100 to 500 microgram. Take a separate another test tube, label it as blank, and in that you are going to take only 1 ml of the distilled water. Then we have to prepare the unknown solution. So with the unknown solution, you take 2 test tubes, label it as unknown 1 and unknown 2. So from the given unknown solution, pipette out 0.5 ml as one aliquot and 0.7 ml as another aliquot into 2 separate tubes which you have labeled as unknown 1 and unknown 2. Then these solution also, the final volume has to be made up to 1 ml with distilled water. After that, to all the test tubes, that is your blank tube, your working standard tubes, your unknown tubes, add 5 ml of the diphenylamine reagent and mix it thoroughly. After that, place all the tubes in a boiling water bath for 15 minutes for the reaction to be completed. After 15 minutes, remove your tubes, cool the tubes to room temperature and note down the absorbance of the blue color obtained at 595 nanometer against a reagent blank. And lastly, you have to plot a standard graph. Take a graph sheet and plot the concentration of the working standard DNA in microgram along the x-axis and absorbance at 595 nanometer along the y-axis. And from the obtained unknown 1 and unknown 2 absorbance values, cut it with your standard graph and try to determine the concentration of the DNA present in the unknown solution. So this is the observation and this is the tabular column. Please make a note of it. So the first column indicates a serial number labeled as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which indicates the standard tubes. Then we have one tube labeled as the blank and 2 tubes labeled as unknown 1 and unknown 2. And this is the volume of the working standard DNA which you are going to take in your standard tubes. Blank, nothing we are going to add. Then 2 aliquots of your unknown solution, 0.5 ml and 0.7 ml has to be pipetted out. And this is the concentration of the working standard DNA what we have pipetted out in the tubes labeled as 1 to 5, starting from 100 microgram and going till 500 microgram. And the last 2 row, you are going to put it as question mark because this is what we are going to find out after the experiment is over. Then the next column indicates the volume of distilled water. As we take 0.2 ml of the standard, we are going to add up 0.8 ml of the distilled water so that the total volume in the first tube will come to 1 ml. So we have to follow the same protocol and make sure that the total volume in all the standard and the unknown pipettes solution comes to 1 ml. Then in the blank tube, we are going to take only 1 ml of the distilled water. After pipetting the distilled water and making it up to final volume of 1 ml, now 5 ml of the diphenyl amine reagent has to be added to all the tubes, that includes your standard tubes, blank, as well as the unknown tubes. After adding them, place all the tubes in a boiling water bath for 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, remove the tubes, cool the tubes and take the absorbance at 595 nanometer. After the reading is over, this is the calculation what you are supposed to do. So we have taken two aliquots for your unknown solution. So plot the graph with those absorbance values you have to cut in your standard graph shape. Okay, so this is the steps what you have to follow to do your calculation. The first aliquot what you have taken is 0.5 ml. So 0.5 ml of the unknown DNA standard solution will correspond to X microgram per ml from the standard graph. Therefore, 1 ml, you have pipetted out 5 ml. So therefore, 1 ml of your unknown solution will correspond to how much? So 1 ml into X divided by 0.5 ml. So this will give you the concentration of your first aliquot, which you are going to label it as A. Next is 0.7 ml of your unknown DNA solution corresponds to Y microgram per ml from the standard graph. Therefore, for 1 ml of the unknown solution, how much it will correspond to? So cross multiplication, Y microgram into 1 divided by the volume of your unknown solution taken, that is 0.7 ml. So this calculation will give you the sample B aliquot's concentration. So now finally we are determining the concentration of DNA present in the given unknown sample by taking up the first concentration A, adding up with the second concentration, that is B, and dividing it by 2. So that will give you the concentration of the DNA that is present in the unknown solution, which will be represented in the units of microgram per ml. Then lastly, you are supposed to write the result. The amount of the DNA present in the given unknown solution was found to be, what is the quantity you have got, that you have to write it, and without fail, you have to write the units as microgram per ml. And this is the reference textbook which we have used in order to compile the aim, principle, procedure, observation, calculation for this particular experiment.
When DNA is treated with DPA in acidic condition, blue color compound will be formed at sharp absorption at 595 nanometer, and beta hydroxylinolenic aldehyde will be formed. It is intermediate and highly reactive.
Yes. Yes, so that is perfect. So one more point, Richa, that you have to make sure that the reaction is only with the 2-deoxypentose sugar. We have DNA, you have bases on the DNA, but the bases are not reacting with your DPA under acidic condition. The sugar in the form of 2-deoxyribose sugar present is only one involved in the reaction. Okay, so there are two important requirements. One is going to be the working standard DNA. Note down the concentration, 500 microgram per ml. The second reagent is the diphenyl amine reagent. So two reagents we will require. So we have kept the things ready. We can start to do the pipetting and then take the absorbance. So when we are setting up few of these things, I kindly request all the 32 I'm finding, that means 31 are there. Everybody keep your graph sheets ready. All 32 or 31 present. That is the working standard urine solution concentration is 50 milligram in 100 ml. This is 50 ml standard plus. So I have taken 25 milligram of the DNA and I have dissolved it in the 50 ml of the saline citrate buffer solution. I hope you are able to hear me.
Yes, ma'am.
So
yes,
this ma'am. Is the standard which I transferred some amount from this from the standard plus into the beaker. Okay. Then we require the unknown solution DNA. So this is also being prepared, unknown DNA that is being kept here in the beaker. So we have to find the concentration for this unknown DNA solution. Then we require distilled water. So we have kept the distilled water also in a beaker. This is the DPA reagent. So DPA reagent is prepared with diphenylamine, 1 gram of diphenylamine in 100 ml of the glycerolactic acid, and to that we have to add 2.5 ml of the concentrated sulfuric acid. So this is the DPA reagent. So next thing is we have taken the series of test tubes which we have labeled them. So this is the blank tube and this is the series of the standard test tubes, 5 in number, what we have taken for the experiment. This is UK1, UK2. Below each and every test tube, I have written their respective volumes and also concentration, what it will correspond to. UK1, the quantity of the aliquot, what we are going to take is 0.5 ml and the aliquot another one is 0.7 ml. Okay. So we will start with the pipetting process. So I have taken a micropipette. It is 1000 microliter. That means its capacity is 1 ml. So let us first add the DNA solution working standard. So the first tube, the volume is how much?
0.2, ma'am.
So I have kept it as 200 microliter. And this is the working standard DNA solution. So I'm going to take 0.2 ml of the working standard and add it in tube number 1, where its concentration will correspond to 100 microgram. Okay. So this is first tube, so 0.2 ml, which is corresponding to 100 microgram. Then I am shifting the micropipette to 400 microliter. That will correspond to 0.4 ml. So that is required for the second test tube. So I've taken 0.4 ml and I've added to the second tube. So its concentration of the standard will become now 200 microliter. Then I am increasing it and getting it to 600 microliter so that the volume will become now to 0.6 ml. So this 0.6 ml of the standard, what I have taken in tube number 3, its concentration will correspond to 300 microgram. Then I'm shifting or increasing it to 800 microliters. That will correspond to 0.8 ml. So now I'm adding that into the fourth tube. So its concentration will be 400 microgram. And the last one is 1000 That means it is going to be 1 ml of the working standard, which will be taken up in the cube number 5. So this is 1 ml of the working standard DNA taken in the cube number 5. So we have finished pipetting out the working standard DNA solution. Now we will make it up to 1 ml with distilled water first. So the micropipette has already been set to 1000. So I will take 1 ml of this distilled water in the blank test tube. Blank contains only 1 ml of the distilled water. Now tube number 1, we have taken 0.2 ml of the standard. So I should add now 0.8 ml of the distilled water so that the total volume will become now 1 ml. So I take 800 microliter, that is 0.8 ml, and add to 0.2 ml of the working standard. Now the total volume in the tube is now 1 ml. Similarly, I change it to 600 microliters. So that will become now 0.6 ml. That is required for tube number 2 because we have taken 0.4 ml of the standard solution. So I'm adding 0.6 ml of the water. Then I am changing it to 400 microliters. That is required volume in the case of next tube. So 400 microliters, tube number 3. Then the next tube, it is 200 microliters. So this is the quantity of water we are adding in the fourth tube. Now the total volume in all the blank and your standards has come to 1 ml. Now we will do the unknown solution pipetting. So this is unknown solution. You have to take two aliquots. Why two aliquots? You can take even three aliquots also. This is only to minimize the error. So the volume required in unknown one is going to be 500 microliter or 0.5 ml. So I am going to take 0.5 ml of the unknown solution into our first tube labeled as unknown one, UK one. Then I am going to increase it to 700 microliters. So this volume will come up to 0.7 ml. So that becomes the unknown two, second aliquot. Okay. So we have taken two unknown solution, two different aliquots we have taken. So now we should make it up to 1 ml with the distilled water. So the distilled water, remember, unknown one is 0.5 ml of standard. So I should add 0.5 ml of the distilled water. So I am changing it to 0.5. Now I am going to add the distilled water. So 0.5 ml of the unknown solution, 0.5 ml of your water, the total volume will become now 1 ml. Similarly, the next aliquot is 300 microliters because we have taken 0.7 ml of the unknown solution. So you should have 300 microliters or 0.3 ml of your water. So that makes up the pipetting of all your standards, blank as well as the unknown solution. So this is the blank tube, contains only 1 ml of distilled water. Then you have a series of test tubes labeled as 1 to 5, which is having the working standard DNA solution with concentrations ranging from 100 to 500 micrograms. This is the two unknown solutions labeled as UK1 and UK2. It contains 0.5 ml of your unknown and 0.7 ml of the unknown solution. What is the next step you are supposed to do? You are supposed to add 5 ml of the diphenylamine reagent to all the test tubes. As you know, we are preparing the DPA reagent by using the glycylic acid, concentrated sulfuric acid. So you know it is acid. So you cannot mock pipette it. So it is okay for to go with addition or using the reagent. So this is the DPA. 1 gram of DPA prepared with 100 ml of glycylic acid, and we have taken our
What we do is that first we will rinse it. We have to rinse the burette with the DPA reagent. So very carefully rotate the burette so that the whole burette is not able to use the DPA reagent. Allow me to get it. So after rinsing it, we can decant the. We will decant it with glycerin acid, something to keep away from your face, your eyes, and your nose. So, each you drink that. 5 ml. So we have 8 cubes. This is 50 ml burette. The burette is being set. Now we will apply the DPA to all our cells. So this is a blank tube. Volume is only 5 ml. Make sure we have only 5 ml of the solution. Next is tube number 1, 5 ml of the DPA reagent. Always keep an eye on the water bath to make sure that the water is boiling. The water should boil thoroughly, then only we are supposed to place the test tube. Otherwise, the reaction will be incomplete and you will not get the proper absorbance and concentration will not be correct. So if it is given as boiling water bath, the water should boil. So adding next 5 ml to the next test tube. As you know, it is a colorless solution, so be careful with the meniscus. Looking in for the small meniscus. Colored solution, always upper meniscus. So this is colorless. So I am just looking in for the lower meniscus. So we are done with the blank, we are done with the tandem. Fifth tube is this one. Now we are supposed to add the unknown solution. 5 ml has to be. This is UK1 and 95 ml of the DPA. And this is UK2. So we are done with the addition. So we transfer the solution back into the beaker. So to prepare the acid, what we need to do is to be careful. So we need to use the rinse. Now we have added all the solution standard and as well as the DPA radio. Now we have to place it in the body. So we have kept two beakers in the hot plate, the temperature is kept. So I'm just placing all the tubes. So you can note down the time. And after 15 minutes, we'll stop the reaction by removing the tubes from the water bath. So you know that the liquid what we have kept is 5 ml in a boiling water bath. When we are placing it, we have to place the marbles on the test tubes. Why we have to place marbles on these test tubes? This is only to prevent the evaporation, because you are keeping it for boiling for 15 minutes. So the contents may evaporate. They evaporate, then there will be a variation in the concentration. So we are going to keep the marbles. So this will prevent the evaporation. The contents will be fine. So we have placed them. You can note down the time for 15 minutes. And then we have to remove the tubes and put it into a beaker which contains the water, tap water for cooling the tubes. And then take the absorbent in the color meter at 595 nanometer.
The tablet column, all of you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
ma'am.
Yes. So, yeah. So once we take the readings, you note down all the values. I hope everyone is having your graph sheet with you. So simultaneously, you can plot the graph and give me the concentration after calculation. Now, how did you calculate the concentration? When we say that if I take 0.2 ml of the standard, it is corresponding to 100 microgram. That is what the tabular column is reflecting, is it not? So how did we get into the point of 100 microgram per ml when we have prepared it as 50 milligram in 100 ml? That is a total concentration in a 100 ml solution, is it not?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, how did we get 100 microgram? 1 ml is 500 microgram. How did we get it? Yes, students, how did you get it? How did we calculate?
Multiplying the concentration with the volume, ma'am.
How did you do that one, Priyanka? Can you share your note if you've done the calculation? You can put your video on and you can show it to me. 100 microgram. That is what I want. You understood?
Yes, ma'am.
So what is the thing? So it is 100 because this tabular column is already given to you. So you are telling 0.2 ml is 100 microgram. If I am not giving you the tabular column, I am just telling you that students, the concentration of today's experiment, the DNA is 100 microgram per ml. I am stopping this much only. Then I am asking you to draw the tabular column. That time I will take, you take 0.2 ml, you take 0.4 ml. Then I will ask, students, the solution is prepared for 100 ml. From that 100 ml, you are pipetting 0.2 ml. So what will be its concentration? This is the question what I'll ask later. You have seen the tabular column, so you are telling 100 micrograms, 0.2 ml. But you have to calculate, no?
Ma'am, we can apply the same logic here also. Like for 100 ml, it is 50 mg. And for 0.2 is X.
Yes. Very good. That is what? Simple logic. That's all. Because already all the answers are there in front of you. When I take 100 ml, I have taken 50 milligram in that one. Okay. Therefore, from out of this 100 ml, if I pipette out to 0.2 ml, then what will be its concentration? Now you tell, this is cross multiplication. That means 0.2 into 50 divided by 100. So what answer you will get, children?
1 what?
Yes, units are very important. 1 milligram. 1 milligram, is it 1 milligram?
0.1 milligram.
So 0.1 milligram. Okay, so you can write the answer in 0.1 milligram or you can convert it into microgram. So when you convert into microgram, it will become 100 micrograms. So always for all the experiments, the standard solution concentration will be given to us. We have to calculate depending on the volume what you are going to pipette out from your standard solution. Okay, so what is how much we have weighed? 50 milligram. So the solution is 100 ml, its concentration is 50 milligram. We know the concentration, that is why we are calling it as a standard solution. Because you know the concentration, how much you are taking, how much you are adding, in how much ml you have added. So we already know the concentration of the prepared solution. So that is why we write 100 ml of the prepared DNA solution, its concentration is 50 milligram. Therefore, from this 100 ml, from this prepared 100 ml, if I pipette out 0.4 ml, then what will be its concentration? So simple cross multiplication, 0.4 into 50 divided by 100. These two gets cancelled, 5, this 2. So that means it is 0.4 divided by 2. That is nothing but 0.2 microgram. Or how much? Microgram or milligram?
Milligram.
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 Yeah. 0.2 milligram or 200 microgram. After 15 minutes, you will let me know so that I will stop it.
Yes, ma'am.
How much
more
time it has
minutes.
Been?
Five minutes is left off, ma'am. I kept timer, ma'am.
Okay. Yeah. You inform me once it is done. Now, Rahul, okay. You tell me.
0.3 milligrams.
Yes, many of them are answering. So it is 0.3 milligram or it is 300 microgram. Okay, then what is the next volume you have taken? It is 0.8 ml. So it is 0.8 into 50 divided by 100. So 5, 2, that means 0.8 divided by 2. So that becomes 0.4 milligram or 400 microgram. Okay. What is the last volume we have taken? 1 ml. So 1 into 50 milligram divided by 100. So that becomes 2. 1 by 2 is half. That means 0.5 milligram or it is 500 microgram. So this is how you calculate the standard values from the given standard concentration. Then you will enter all these values in your tabular column according to the aliquots what we have taken. Okay, children, is that clear? Next will be RNA estimation. So,
sir, you are able to see? Yes, ma'am. Okay, so time is up. Can I remove it?
Yes, ma'am, time is up.
Yeah, so I'll stop it and I will remove the tubes.
You can see the difference in the blank. There is no any color because in the blank we have added only water. No deoxyribose sugar is there, is it not? So that is why. So I'm keeping all the tubes for cooling. So let them cool. Now you can see this at the colorimeter.
So the wavelength is 595 nanometer, children. So in this colorimeter, we have two ways of taking the readings. One is percentage transmittance and the other one is absorbance. At present, it is in percentage transmission. So I have to convert it into absorbance. So once I convert into absorbance, some reading has been displayed here, and you can see the wavelength what we have set here is 600 nanometers because the previous wavelength what is there in this filter is only 570. So 595 is not there. So
So I am keeping it as 600 as the wavelength. Now this is the distilled water what we have taken, because before starting with your experiment, also set the colorimeter. So this is the distilled water. So we have to clean the distilled water outside surface with the tissue paper, insert it, and we have to set it to 00. So with distilled water, we have set the equipment to 0.00. Then we have to take two other glass cuvettes, and then we have to take in one blank solution, and another one we have to take the standard and the unknown solution and take the reading. We will see whether they have cooled up. A little bit warm it is. While you're taking the readings, make sure that you're cooling the tubes and only taking the readings. If they are very hot or if they're warm, that time if you take the reading, there will be a lot of difference in the absorbance value, because it will deviate from the Beer-Lambert's law. So it's always make sure that the tubes cool down thoroughly, and then we will start to take the readings. So temperature will have an influence on the absorbance. Okay. So I will remove the tubes now. This is tube number one. So you can see beautiful blue color which has come. And this is the blank solution. You can see the blank, there is no any color. Then this is tube number four. This is tube number two. This is tube number, this is unknown two. Tube number five, this is three, and this is unknown one. So you can see the difference in the color also, because we have taken it from 0.2 ml, 100 microgram to 500 microgram. You can see the difference in the intensity of the color. Okay, so now we will start to take the absorbance. So in one cuvette, I'm going to take the blank. Now, whenever you're taking the solutions inside the cuvette, make sure that you are not overflowing there. And also make sure that 3/4 of your cuvette is filled with the solution. So that is very important. Okay. So clean the outside of the cuvette, and now remove the blank and place water and place now the blank solution. Now you can see it is showing me 0.01, so I'm adjusting it to 0.00. okay, so now with another cuvette I will take the first tube. So I can note down the absorbance once we get the absorbance value. So I'm taking the first one. So remove the first cuvette and insert your test solution. What is the readings you are getting? 0.04. Okay, note it down, children. 0.04 or 0.5. 0.5, you can note it down. I'm pouring it back into the tube number one. Then we'll go to tube number two. So 3/4 always is preferable to be taken so that you will get the correct value. So that the light which is falling on your solution will be proper. 0.08. Then this is third one. This is fourth tube. Don't spill it outside and all, children, because it is prepared with DPA is prepared with base lactic acid as well as H2SO4. So you should be very careful while you are transferring the solution into the cuvette. 0.14. So with the last one. And note down the value 0.16. Now, because we have to do with the unknown, let us rinse it once with the water. So, because of rinsing, it is becoming turbid. We will take another cuvette where it is already having the distiller in this cuvette case. Unknown one, this is. So 0.09. Children, note it down. Unknown one is 0.09. Then this is unknown two. I hope you all have noted down the reading.
Yes, ma'am.
So transfer the solution to respective tube. Keep them for washing and switch off the equipment. So minimum number of amount of usage of all your samples. Now you plot the graph. We have finished the standards and cut the unknowns and report me the results. Okay, children.
0.16. So there is a hitch in the last two tubes. 4 is only 0.14 and 5 is only 0.16. So there is some error in the last two tubes. Okay. Unknown 1 was 0.09, if I'm not wrong. Unknown 2 is
0.14, ma'am.
14. Okay. Plot the graph. Values are there. Those who have not noted it down. Note down the standard values and the unknown values. Plot the graph. How are you going to plot the graph? You have to draw the axis. You use your pencil and scale neatly to draw it. So along this is the x-axis. So it is going to be the concentration of working standard DNA. So this will be in microgram per ml, mu. Like this you should write mu. This is microgram. Microgram per ml. And along this side you will be writing the absorbance. At which way nanometer? 595 nanometer. Okay. Here you can write it as 100 microgram, 200 microgram, 300, 400, and 500, and you finalize what must be your absorbance along the y-axis based on the readings. Don't forget, you are always supposed to write the scale. So you will write in x-axis 1 centimeter if you are drawing, or 2 centimeter is equal to 100 microgram. Y-axis 1 centimeter is equal to, you can put 0.02, that's all. There are no any units for the absorbance, 0.02. Children,
children are plotting the graph. Anyone has finished?
Micrograms.
Yes. How much?
475 microgram per ml.
Very good, Richa. Very good. Yes, I will tell what must be the concentration. Okay, others? Have you finished? Others?
Ma'am, for me it came 528, ma'am.
It all varies because Priyanka, how you are cutting your values plays a very important role. Each one, if you cut it differently, then the values what you are going to get will be different. Let us see for the others what they are getting. Then I will tell what is the correct concentration, what you should have got for the unknown, what we have prepared today.
Ma'am, is the correct concentration in a range or is it specific, ma'am? Like one number or is there
specific? Between? Only one number. This is the graph which you can get it if you are drawing with the values what I have plotted.
Yes, ma'am, I got the same.
Same, yes. So,
but reading is 528 coming, ma'am, so high.
Let me see. Unknown one is how much? 0.09.
Ma'am. Yes, ma'am, 0.09.
09 means I have to change my values here. It comes in between these two, is it not? So, so
Now I'm getting 700 wrong.
700 is wrong, Shivani. When you are, see, always remember, when the standard concentration is only 500 and your unknown value should lie only within that 500. Never it should be more than 500. That means your calculation, some mistake must be there. Check it out. Check it out with your calculation. Deepa, somewhere you got here in between 250, 200, something like that.
Yes, ma'am, it's 250, ma'am.
What about the others? First one?
Yes, ma'am, 250, ma'am.
Yes.
240, ma'am.
Yeah. Yeah, 240, 250, 260, something must be the range for the first absorbance. Next
yes,
one
ma'am,
is 0.5. 250 means it will be double. So 1 ml it will become 500 microgram. Am I right?
Yes, ma'am.
That is what you should get for your first calculation. Now next one is 0.14, I think, is it not?
14, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So we will see where what we are getting. Somewhere here. Maybe 370 to 370 or 380. 370. Okay, 370. So let us see whether the calculation we will do here and see. So what we have taken is 0.5 ml, is it not? So 0.5 ml, according to my graph, let me assume it as 250 microgram. Okay, so therefore for 1 ml, how much it is? So 250 into 1 divided by 0.5, that will come up to 500 microgram per ml. Okay, next one is 0.7 ml is corresponding to 370, let us assume. Then 1 ml will correspond to how much? So 1 into 370 divided by 0.7. So how much it will be?
528. 528.
250.
Yeah, I am using my technology calculator. Yes, what is it? 370 into 1, is it not? Is equal to divided by 0.7, is equal to how much? 528.5. Okay, so I will write it as 528.7 microgram per ml. Okay, so having the, how to calculate I gave you, is it not? So this is A. Yes, this is B. So 500 plus 528.7 divided by 2. So take my calculator. So it is 500 plus 528.7 and put is equal to, then you divide it by 2, is equal to how much you got? 514.35. This is my answer for the graph what I have drawn here.